Please welcome to the stage, Steve Thompson. Starring Olivia Newton-John as a muse that comes to Earth to help a struggling artist named Sonny realize his dream of opening a roller disco. And there's an animated sequence right in the middle of it. It's one of my biggest inspirations, and I'm more than happy to answer any questions you have about it during the Q&A, but for now, let's get started. Thank you and welcome to AIGA's 2018 Phoenix Design Week. I'm Steve Thompson. I've been an artist for the Walt Disney Company since 1994. Currently, I am principal designer for the Disney stores where I've been since 2005. So what exactly does a principal designer do? Without being too technical about it, I'm responsible for creating artwork and also creating the designs that will eventually become 3D sculpted items, like snow globes, Christmas ornaments, a lot of Christmas ornaments, tree toppers, cookie jars, collectible figures, and of course, all of the artwork for our limited edition dolls. The series that's on the screen right now just launched today with Snow White, and she sold out in less than 20 minutes, so that was really exciting this morning. This isn't necessarily where I planned my career would end up, but it's where things went, so I'll get to that in a moment. But for now, let's focus on me being asked to actually come give this speech. When I was first asked to give a keynote speech, my first reaction was no. Not because I didn't think it was important, because I was terrified. You know, I'm 44 years old, and I've been in my career for almost 25 years, but I still feel like that 19-year-old kid, the kid who was hired out of CalArts to work at Disney Consumer Products, drawing Pocahontas on everything from book covers to collectible plates and even Sega video game covers, if you remember what Sega is. So, however, I've learned that one of the secrets to a long career is working through your fear. So despite everything of me saying no, I said yes. So this year's theme, Beyond Design, what does it mean? For me, Beyond Design is how we live our lives. It's how I approach my job. I don't just want people to buy the stuff that I design because it has a function. I want people to look beyond the design and actually have an emotional connection with the stuff that I've created. When they want, not only for themselves, but also for friends and family. And I got to that point in my career by drawing from life. The first film I ever saw in the theaters was The Many Adventures of Winnie the Pooh. It was 1977, I was 3 years old, and I was obsessed with this film. It completely changed my life at 3 years old. So obsessed that to this day, my dad still calls me Tigger. But I don't know what it was about animation, because I don't care if it's hand-drawn, stop-motion, or computer-animated. Animation takes you emotionally to another place, whether it's the story or the characters. Whatever it was, I feel like watching animation for me is like watching magic. And I was raised on Saturday morning cartoons and the Disney Channel. And drawing, I'm told, before I could walk or talk on literally everything. If there wasn't paper available, the underside of our furniture at home made for a perfect substitute. So luckily I had cool parents about that. And all through school, I would get in trouble for drawing during class when I should have been paying attention to the teacher. Now, a big turning point came for me in junior high school. I was hanging out at home with my friend Roxanne, drawing, obviously. And she said she wanted to be an artist for Disney when she grew up. And in that moment, I realized that I could have a career doing something that I already love doing. So in that moment, I'm like, yes, this is obviously what I'm going to do with my life. And school was horrible. By high school, I was regularly pushed into lockers and had food thrown at me. I had my car vandalized and even received death threats at home. This was a pre-Will and Grace, pre-Queer Eye the first time around. Ellen DeGeneres coming out world we were living in. So back then, being the fat gay punk rocker from a super conservative Walnut Creek, California, wasn't exactly considered cool by the popular kids. One of my art teachers even told me I would never make anything of myself drawing cartoons. But drawing provided me an escape from that. It gave me the feeling that I was special, and I knew it was something not everyone could do. I felt like it was my superpower. I still feel like it's my superpower. And while one art teacher told me I would never make anything of myself, another one changed my life. Her name was Mrs. Converse. Picture Lily Tomlin's character from Grace and Frankie, but in her 40s with blonde hair, silver turquoise jewelry with flowy dresses, and of course, a huge love of Georgia O'Keeffe. It was my sophomore year and I felt comfortable in her class because she gave us a safe space to create in. She noticed I was quite good for my age and took notice of what I was doing. And when I told her that my ultimate goal was to work for Disney as an artist, she didn't look at me like I was crazy. But she did have this piece of advice. She said, if you want to get better at drawing, you're gonna have to start drawing from life. I thought about it for a while and asked her what she meant. She didn't explain it to me, but instead said we would just start with still life drawing, which is not my favorite thing in the world. It's a bowl of fruit or a vase of flowers. But for the first time in my life, I realized that I was actually drawing something that I saw, not something that someone had drawn before me or something that I was just copying out of a book. So she recommended I try figure drawing classes, and obviously this is something that high school could not provide to me. So I found myself traveling into San Francisco to take life drawing at the Academy of Art College. Here I learned anatomy, weight, and balance, everything I wasn't thinking about when I was just copying pictures of Mickey, Goofy, or Roger Rabbit out of a book or magazine. And I was building a mental reference library without even realizing it. I was, for the first time in my life, drawing from life. At the end of my junior year in high school, I wrote a letter to the Disney Animation Studios, not to any particular person. I only had the main address, but I did a bunch of drawings on the envelope, hoping it would get someone's attention. I was asking where I should go to school once I graduated if I wanted to work for Disney in the future. And the crazy part is someone took the time to write me back, like they wrote an actual letter. And they sent me information on the California Institute of the Arts and said this was definitely the school that you would want to check out if you were serious about working for the company. So I called CalArts, I bundled up my art, and I traveled to LA to tour the school. And I'm a little embarrassed looking back, but when I say bundled my art into a portfolio, it was this enormous portfolio that was the size of my body and the thickness of a suitcase. There was no organization to it. I think it was probably every piece of artwork I'd created up to that time, but I wanted to show them everything I could do. And luckily no one said anything about my presentation or lack thereof, but I got some initial positive feedback and advice on what I needed to do when I planned to apply in the fall. And then 2 weeks later, I got a phone call from the school, and they said there was no need for me to apply, which initially terrified me. But instead, they told me they were saving me a space, and that upon graduation, I would be attending my dream school. I was told one of the reasons why I bypassed the initial application process was because of my life drawings, and that it was important for artists and potential animators to know how to draw from life, and they could see that I knew that. So fast forward 2 years later, at the end of my second year at CalArts, I submitted my portfolio again. This time it was a little more professional looking, and it was for Disney. It was the year-end portfolio review. I was hoping maybe to get some feedback on my portfolio and at best a summer internship. And instead of that, I was offered a job at 19 years old, so thank you, Mrs. Converse. I get asked all the time what the secret to drawing animated characters is, and my answer is always life drawing. You need to know the foundation before you can create a convincing character. Now, for life drawing, there's both a literal and figurative side to this. For me, drawing from life isn't just the act of drawing a still life or attending a life drawing class or taking my sketchbook with me when we travel. It's also about opening your eyes to the world around you and seeing how life can influence your creative process. When I attend life drawing on a regular basis, it fuels my creative mind. I notice improvement in my drawing, but it's also contributing to that mental reference library, and I use that in my everyday designer life. I'm always paying attention to how people walk or gesture or stand, often thinking that would make a really great drawing, or I need to remember that. Because when I'm drawing a character, I feel like I'm inhabiting them for a brief moment in time. So if I'm drawing Grumpy from Snow White, I'm sure that while I'm drawing, I'm taking on this like angry posture and I have this like, you know, leave me alone look on my face while I'm drawing. But I feel like that character is in me and trying to get out. So it's like it's coming out of me through the pencil, out onto the paper, and then I can sort of let that go. So having that mental reference library from observing people and drawing from life can make a drawing feel more authentic and definitely be the difference between a good drawing and a great drawing. Now to catch up, I went from CalArts to Disney Consumer Products. And after my first year there, I was hired by Disney Feature Animation, which was my life's goal. It was the job that I would retire from in my old age, or so I thought. I worked on quite a few films while I was there, Hunchback of Notre Dame, Hercules, Tarzan, to name a few. I was working with really amazing people on incredible projects, and we were making magic. Things started to take a turn for the worse. Some people thought maybe the stories we were working on were a little lacking, or computer animation was the shiny new toy that everyone was excited about. But for whatever the reason, Disney Feature Animation closed their doors to traditional animation in late 2003. The last film that I worked on was a film called Home on the Range, drawing a cow named Maggie, voiced by Roseanne Barr. So that wasn't exactly the swan song I was looking for. But apparently I was too busy busting a moo to realize that I needed to start looking for work. This was a really traumatic time for me, admittedly. This job was my life's goal and I had made it. Not only was I good at what I did, but I absolutely loved doing it. And I was being let go for something completely beyond my control. And it's the main reason why this many years later, I never, ever take for granted what I get to do for a living. Before getting laid off, I went back to life drawing. I needed to update my portfolio, and this seemed like a really good place to start. I worked briefly at Disney Toon Studios and Disney Television Animation for a bit, but was looking for something more stable. This led to the job at the Disney stores. They were interviewing for a product designer, and I had never designed product before, but I love to buy things, and I'm a collector, so I even worked at a local Disney store when I was in high school. It all seemed perfect. It was something I never pictured myself doing before. I didn't go to school for it. The job required someone that could draw, so I figured it was at least worth being open to draw from that opportunity that was coming my way and not question it. I was offered the job, and for the first time in my life, and possibly out of a little desperation, I didn't question what was happening and found myself really excited about new possibilities. But here's a little secret. Whenever I get a new assignment, even after 13 years on the job, I can't help but feel like my best ideas are behind me, that I can't possibly come up with something better than whatever it was I just finished, and that I'm in fact all out of ideas. I've been doing this long enough to realize that I have a very strong opinion on how things should look, what I like, what I don't like. I also know I have the skills to do the job, but when it comes to new assignments, I always hesitate. I think about it for a while and convince myself that this is going to be the time everyone figures out I've been faking it. How many of you have ever felt that way? I've learned this is also normal. So normal, in fact, that when I mention it to any of my designer or artist friends, they all tell me they go through the same thing, so I do find comfort in knowing I am not alone here. I like to call it artist brain. And I've learned that these moments of self-doubt are part of my creative process, which leads me to my creative process. When I'm first getting started on a project, the trick for me is to find something to take my mind off of the fact that I feel like I have no idea what I'm doing. I answer those emails that just need a quick yes or no to keep things moving along, or create a list that I can check off of easy projects so I feel like a bunch of stuff is getting done, anything to sort of clear my head and make room for all of that creative space that I need to tackle a huge project. And I know some people look at me like I'm procrastinating, but I like to think of it as sort of the quiet before the storm, because I know there's a million ideas swirling around in the back of my head and I'm just waiting for that right one. And when I land on it, I'm ready to go. Since I work exclusively on character-based product, whether I'm creating artwork or designing sculpted items, staying true to the characters and their stories is the most important part no matter what the item is. But unlike a drawing, a sculpt needs to look good from every angle. And I'm not a sculptor myself, but I need to think about the stuff that I'm designing as if I am a sculptor, so that the direction is clear for the sculptors I'll eventually be working with. So I might start just by scanning through film, seeing if anything catches my eye, wondering what would somebody want that they don't already have. And really, at the end of the day, I'm wondering what would I want. And that's only a little bit of a joke, because like I said, I'm a Disney collector, so I'm the target audience. So I do use that as a filter, hoping that if it resonates with me, I'm hoping that it resonates with other Disney fans. For example, when we were working on a Beauty and the Beast anniversary collection, I thought, who wouldn't want a Cogsworth full-scale replica working clock? And who wouldn't want Lumiere candelabra or a Mrs. Potts tea set? And when we were working on Pinocchio, I thought, obviously, we're going to make a full-scale replica marionette of Pinocchio because it would just be so cool, and I needed one. Working on films that can be as much as 80 years old, like in the example Snow White, it can be a unique challenge. The really cool thing about working on existing films is you have all the reference you could ever dream of, but unlike all films, there's only so many really memorable scenes, and on top of that, only so many of those that resonate and work really well for product. And with a film as old as Snow White, you can imagine they've all been done a million times. So the challenge for me is, how do you make it feel fresh? How do you make it feel new for people? And using Snow White again as an example, one of my very first big solo projects was to come up with a Snow White garden collection. So I I first had to figure out what that meant and what someone would need in their garden. I had to figure out what items we could put that Disney spin on and what could just be really fun and unexpected. So my inspiration came from the film itself and that mental reference library of studying art and life drawing, all that. The color palette and the natural setting of the film reminded me of the arts and crafts movement that was popular at the time of the film's release, which in turn inspired the use of natural materials like wood, metal, ceramic. Along with that beautiful muted palette, it just felt right. In the collection, I came up with everything from garden statues to candle holders, wind chimes, garden stakes. A lot of stuff that's not even shown in these photos, but the really fun pieces for me about a birdhouse in the shape of the dwarf's cottage, or a bird feeder shaped like the wishing well. This is putting that Disney spin on things. And it came from having a really clear theme and art direction. You see, sometimes in product design, we're so busy chasing trends that we completely lose sight of what made us fall in love with these characters and in love with these films in the first place. So my instinct was to go back to the film and let that inspire me. And when the product eventually did hit the stores, the feedback from guests was that it felt new and it felt fresh and it felt authentic. So from this experience, I learned that sometimes taking a project all the way back to its origins can make it feel timeless. Disney movies are timeless, and the product can be too. So this is something I keep in mind at the start of every new project. And while working on existing films has its challenges, working on new films presents new ones. The stories, the characters are changing at this time because we're working anywhere from 12 to 16 months out from when we are working on concepts to when it actually makes it to the stores. And the films are still changing at this time. The characters are changing and evolving. So this is the one instance where we really heavily depend on filmmakers. We meet with the directors, the art directors, and brainstorm what product we could come up with that would best help tell the story they are trying to tell, because they are completely the experts at this time. And if stuff changes, we need to make the changes along with it. For example, when we were working on Frozen, there was a time when Anna and Elsa's dresses kept changing for some reason. And we were fairly deep in product development and were going into production. So we needed to make sure we changed those dresses because our product actually hits the stores before the film. So this is really people's first introduction to who these characters are. So if they come into our stores and pick up a Frozen doll, and then they go see the movie a couple weeks later, we need to make sure that that is the character that's represented. So it's super important that we get it just right, and sometimes just need to be a little bit flexible and let it go. Another huge part of my creative process is thumbnail drawings. These quick sketches allow me to experiment with character poses, interaction, composition, storytelling, all without investing too much time or energy. I just start drawing and I'll sometimes fill a page like this one up on the screen in a matter of minutes with scribbles. And if I don't like what I'm seeing, I just abandon it and move on. I keep going. The point is that there's an energy to this process and I don't ever want to lose that energy in the final product. I can quickly move through a bunch of ideas and know that I'm landing on the right one. It's a way of problem solving and a way of avoiding the whole process of just doing the first thing that comes to your mind, because while sometimes that is the best idea, eventually it's really nice to work through and decide that you are for sure working on the same one. So a few examples of thumbnails versus final product. This is a piece of artwork I created for Snow White's 80th anniversary. These are thumbnails for a Frozen comic book cover that's coming out this month. The thumbnails that I did, a couple of variations on the theme, and I narrowed it down to one that I really felt just represented the story best. And I went on, you can see my cleanup drawing, and then again, the final color. And this final example are a few snow globes. On the left is Beauty and the Beast, obviously. World of Disney in the middle and Little Mermaid on the right-hand side. and then the final product. So you can see in each one of these cases, the final product really is a true representation of my thumbnail sketch. And when I'm working on something, if I ever feel like it's going off track and not feeling right, I always refer back to my thumbnail because I was excited about it. When I, you know, when I find that idea and I'm excited about it, I don't want to lose that excitement. So my strategy is always try to keep it as true to the initial inspiration as possible. So I can't tell you enough how much this part of the process is important and meaningful. From there, things get a little more technical. Say I'm working on an ornament. There are times when the artist brain switches off and it might turn into the product designer brain. I might be wondering if, is this gonna hang straight, or is this too heavy? Is this a breaking point, or is this point too sharp? And those are all really important questions, but it's super important that the artist brain takes back over and solve these problems in a really creative way so that it's not obvious to the people buying the product. At the end of the day, we need to address these issues, but still be innovative and appealing. So once the thumbnails are done, I found that I clean up the concept sketch, and then I start doing turnaround drawings for the sculptor to follow, which leads to a whole other process that I'll keep short, which is the sculpting process. And like I said, I'm not a sculptor, but I know what things should look like from every angle. So this starts a lot of overlays that you can see here really briefly. A lot of notes to get the characters on model, to get the gesture, the expression just the way I imagined it. It can be a really tedious part of the process, but it's ultimately incredibly rewarding when you see the final product and see people interacting with something that you've created that at one point was literally just a thumbnail sketch on a piece of paper. So how do you find your own style? It's a question I also get asked a lot, and it's a super tough question to answer it, but I'll try to. It's not something that you can sit down one day and say to yourself, today is the day I'm going to find my own style. It is indeed a process and a journey. My first piece of advice, if you can, is to shut off your brain and just see where the pencil takes you. It's the same thought process that I have when I'm thumbnailing. For me, when I'm drawing, it's almost like I'm holding a pencil and someone else is controlling what's coming out, and I'm just as surprised at what ends up on the screen or on the paper as anyone else's. But when that happens, I know I'm onto something, and that's really what you need to pay attention to because you're probably headed down the right path. Don't be worried or caught up in the end result. If you're trying too hard and you're struggling, just move on because you're probably not finding your style. There are a million people in your career as an artist that will judge you, so don't judge yourself before you've even started. Another tool that's been incredibly important in my journey for finding my own style is social media. When I was young, we didn't have the internet. We didn't have social media. So there was no way for me to compare myself to anyone else, no way to see what other people were doing. So I just drew what I liked. And as a result, I was super resistant to social media when it first started because I didn't understand it. Until some friends of mine that worked at Disney Interactive said, just start a Tumblr page, because Tumblr was popular at that time. And I finally saw the value. I realized that for years, I avoided doing my own artwork outside of work because I was drawing all day long. So it seemed like a perfect excuse to avoid doing it. Again, but with social media, I realized that now I'm posting new artwork at least 4 or 5 times a week. And you can imagine over the course of years, that becomes a really huge body of work for you to explore and express your personal style. Sometimes it might just be a drawing of myself, a mood that I'm in, or something that's happening at work. Oftentimes it's Disney characters, but in my own style. Maybe a musician that I'm into at the moment, or a film, TV show that I'm super excited about, or maybe a really important event like voting or Pride. So make sure you vote next month. It's really become my way of expressing myself. But it's an act of and not having a preconceived idea of what needs to be drawn. And I've got a limited time to do it, so it forces me to draw what comes naturally and not overthink myself. And it's really helped me find my style in F44. It's kind of exciting to still see it changing and evolving, but still feel uniquely my own. I spent the first half of my career working in animation, where my drawings needed to look exactly like everyone else's in order to bring a character to life. But in the job I currently have, more and more frequently, I'm drawing these characters and creating artwork that is in my very own personal style. And that's really exciting as a big Disney fan to see my style represented and representing these iconic characters. You will find your own style, and it will continue to change, so don't be in a rush to discover it. It will happen without you knowing. Take a moment and think about your early projects, like that first big project you ever had. Think about the challenges that you faced and how you would do it differently. You probably have a pretty strong opinion on how you would approach things differently this time. So that just might be your personal style coming into focus. Another challenge is when your passion becomes your day job. Mine was drawing, obviously, so how do I stay inspired and avoid artist block? For me, it's about staying inspired. There are a ton of artists that inspire me, but these are just a few. Frank Thompson and Ollie Johnson were two lead animators in a core group back in Walt's day that he lovingly referred to as the Nine Old Men. They were lifelong friends and brilliant animators who, after retirement, went on to write really amazing books for Disney, including what's by many considered the Bible of animation for animation students. It's The Illusion of Life. Mark Davis was another one of Walt's Nine Old Men and another incredible animator that animated everyone from Tinkerbell to Cruella de Vil. And again, upon retiring from animation, went on to help Walt design Disneyland. He created the Jungle Cruise, Pirates of the Caribbean, and my personal favorite, the Haunted Mansion. Mary Blair is inspiring to me because she was a really talented female artist at a time when there weren't many women, not only working at the Disney studios, but just working in the industry, period. Her artwork is so colorful and whimsical, it's almost childlike, but her use of color and design is legendary. It's still such a huge inspiration for many of today's top artists at Disney. And those previous three artists, it's kind of cool looking and realizing you can have a long career with the company even if your role changes over time. At least that inspires me. Glenn Keane is my more modern day animation hero. He's responsible for creating characters like Ariel, Beast, Pocahontas. His drawing ability is so incredible that you actually watch these films and believe these characters are real, even if it's one drawing at a time. And finally, Al Hirschfeld. His use of an economy of line, along with his ability to tell a story and capture movement and emotion all in a single frame, is not only inspiring to me, but it's a reminder to not overcomplicate things, which is just a good idea in general. I can see hints of all of these artists and others in my work, but it's somehow filtered through me and comes out in my style. Someone might see this drawing of Rapunzel and think it reminds them of Hirschfeld, but it might just be the way I've used line in a graphic way to communicate a simple idea. Not that it actually looks like a Hirschfeld drawing, but I still take that as a huge compliment. Another way to avoid artist block for me is good TV, movies, travel, photography, or cooking, really anything that inspires me. But I also found inspiration in one unexpected place.
I'm gonna give you my heart. 'Cause you're a sky, 'cause you're a sky full of stars. 'Cause you light up the path. And I don't care.
Terrified of heights. I hate performing, or at least I used to, and I'm generally terrible in large group settings. But after my first circus class, I was totally hooked. It scared me, and it still scares me. And I've been doing this now for almost 10 years. But it's also exciting. It's changed my confidence in what I do and can do as an artist. How often in life have we not done something because we're scared? Scared of failing, scared of being made fun of, or looking stupid? I have all of these fears, but my circus hobby has taught me to step into my fears and face them. It's helped me realize that fear is part of my creative process, and that being afraid is not necessarily a bad thing. It can really show you how strong and capable you are. Most of all, I've found my escape, so when I go back to work, I have a clear head, I feel creative, and while I may have a bad drawing day every now and then, I'm not afraid of it. And that's the key for me to avoiding artist block, is not being afraid. So what inspires you? It doesn't need to be a physical activity like circus, but if it is, I know a really great circus school in Los Angeles. It's whatever makes you feel creative. If you stay curious and interested, you won't get bored. So I challenge you all to find your passion outside of work. Give yourself permission to enjoy that passion and to find your circus. The bigger lesson I've learned through all of this, and I think can apply to all of you as well, is that as artists, we have a really strong vision of where we think our careers should go. I always thought I wanted to work in animation, but later realized that what I really wanted to do was draw. And I was drawing every day and still telling stories in my current role, just a little bit differently than I was when I was working in animation. And it could have been so easy to dismiss the opportunity of becoming a product designer because I was scared of the challenge, or because it wasn't what I decided my path should be back when I was in school. And now looking back, it makes perfect sense how I ended up here. I was open to an opportunity when it came up when I could have said no. So I'll leave you with this quick little story. Glenn Keane, who I mentioned earlier as one of my inspirations, is also somebody that worked in the same building as me at Future Animation. But I never took the opportunity to introduce myself to him because I was terrified of him. Years later, I worked with him on a line of dolls called the Animator Collection. This is where we imagine your favorite Disney characters as toddlers if they were to appear as toddlers in their respective films. And I worked with Glenn and a few other of the top animators at the time, and I even got to add my own doll to the collection, which was Tinkerbell. Glenn, who couldn't be a nicer guy, never saw me as being less than. He saw me as his contemporary who knew what he was doing, and the only person seeing himself as less than was myself. At the end of the project, we sat and talked to one another, artist to artist, And I realized I shouldn't beat myself up for not taking the opportunity to meet him previously, that my journey had brought me to this moment. And at the end of the meeting, Glenn did a sketch of Ariel for me, and on it he wrote, "To Steve, your work is inspiring. Ariel continues to live through you. Keep going." Not only was that a lesson for me in understanding my own value, but his words reminded me of the responsibility I have to these characters and their stories. And the same lesson applies to everyone in this room. Trust your experience and draw from your life to understand your value. I'm not sure Mrs. Converse knew how much her simple comment to draw from life would change my life. It has become the mantra that I live by. It started out with drawing, yes, but became so much more than that. It reminds me to draw from my personal life experience, how my experience with others and the world around me makes me who I am as an artist. It's being inspired and staying inspired by the things you do and the things around you. Drawing from life is beyond design. I see now that the simple act of attending my first life drawing class was just the beginning of a really wonderful journey, and one that I feel like in many ways is just getting started. I still attend life drawing on a regular basis. It reminds me who I was, where I am, and how far I've come. I want to go back and tell my younger self that the experiences ahead are going to be amazing. There will be challenges, obviously, but it's so worth it when you're chasing your dream. So before this weekend is over, I want you all to think about the path you're on. Think about that kid you were when you wanted to grow up and be an artist. Look at how far you've come, and I can bet the younger you would be really proud of where you're at. So be open, be in the moment, and be willing to say yes, even when sometimes you want to say no. Thank you.
Indeed.
If anyone has any questions.
So anyone have a question? We've got the microphones right there.
Hi, I have a question.
Yes.
Has your work evolved since Disney has sharped up Marvel and Star Wars?
My personal job has, because I also work on those properties. So it's interesting that on any given basis, I'm working on four seasons of product at the same time, all in varying degrees of anywhere from concept to approvals, and working on characters as wide-ranging as the very first one, which was Oswald the Lucky Rabbit, all the way through to the latest Star Wars and Marvel films, and keeping them all straight and knowing their history and knowing all the characters and working on all those sculpts. It's pretty intense, but it's exciting.
First of all, I just wanted to say I'm 48, and I totally wore out my bootleg copy of the Xanadu soundtrack back in the day.
Awesome.
I have a question. So, you know, I see when you're working on the products and everything that are going to be put up there in the Disney store, you're trying to kind of capture, stay on model and everything. And
yeah.
Then I see, your personal artwork. Has Disney ever approached you? Have you done anything in your own style for Disney products at all, or is that just personal?
Yeah, a lot more recently, because, like I said, social media has been so important, and they're seeing the value of the number of followers that I have and how people respond to my own artwork. So we've done quite a few art programs that are exclusive to the stores, that are sort of like art of, where it's different artists creating artwork, so I've been part of a number of those, so it's cool to see my own personal artwork on everything from apparel to makeup lines. There was a ColourPop collab that we just did, and it's all totally my own style, and no feedback from anyone most of the time, and it's really rewarding to just have something, not having any idea how it's going to end up, and then all of a sudden it's there, and it's like, yes, we're going to do something with this. So it is happening, definitely.
Hello.
Hi. So,
It's so great to finally meet someone who worked on my favorite Disney movie, Hunchback.
Thank you. Yeah. I love that film.
I know. I was like, the moment you mentioned it, I was like, I have to talk to him. So this might sound like a weird question. So what do you think is the connection, or at least the Venn diagram, of art and design for you?
For me, I don't know if this is going to answer your question, but I think, you know, I didn't go to school for product design. So I came from this really weird background of art and animation and didn't necessarily know how it was going to translate. So the people that gave me a shot at being a product designer really kind of took a gamble with me. And they obviously saw something that I wasn't quite sure at the time. I knew that I had it in me. But they told me that it was exactly because of my ability to draw and luckily be working on characters that somehow translated. It like kind of bridged this gap between design and art for them, because I know just when we're looking for people to help out or there's a new position that opens up, it's really easy to find someone that can draw characters but then can't design product, and it's seemingly easy to find people that are product designers that can't draw characters. So it's this really weird hybrid, and luckily they found me, and for me it's been all one and the same. So I don't know if that answers your question. It's just my personal experience.
Oh no, it does. Thank you.
Sure, thanks.
Hi. So as far as like artist portfolios go, is there some kind of base level skill besides life drawing that's should be kept in? Like if someone is applying to a job as a storyboard artist,
yeah,
you don't really know what they're doing. Yeah. If they have it built up, or what is it?
Yeah, I know from being around, especially at animation studios, I would see a lot more. They would always have portfolio reviews, and they would leave out all the portfolios for, there was a core group that reviewed them, but they were left open for anyone to sort of comment on and look at. And what I heard a lot of is that they don't want to see everything you can do. So if you have, they always want to see life drawing. They don't want to see Disney characters. They want to know that you can draw. So life drawing is definitely important. But then if there's a certain area you're interested in, so if it's storyboarding, they want to see storyboards. They want to see storytelling moments between characters, just stuff that supports what you want to do. I heard quite a few times during portfolio reviews that they hate it saying, here's a portfolio, I'm showing you absolutely everything I can do, and I will take or do any job you have for me. It kind of didn't go over very well, because they wanted people that know what they want to do and are more specialized in it, so that when they're looking at it, you can clear, even without a cover sheet, be like, clearly this person is applying for storyboarding, and they're looking at it through that lens and not looking at it like every couple pages, now I'm seeing backgrounds, now I'm seeing characters, like it just starts to get a little overwhelming. So I think they like to hear that you know what you want to do and that you're going for that position.
Thanks.
Uh-huh.
I wanted to ask, when you do your drawings, when you color them, are you coloring them by hand?
Believe it or not, as traditional of an artist as I am, it's been all digital. It's something that I just started maybe 4 years ago. I kind of avoided it as much as I possibly could, and actually had a Cintiq at my desk for about a year before I tried using it. And luckily I found an art program called Sketchbook Pro, which is not a plug, but it's really an amazing program for someone like myself who comes from such a traditional background that computers terrify me. And I found that it literally was just like coloring and drawing on a screen, and it was so simple to use. Like I have no idea how to use Photoshop or Illustrator, and thank God I don't know have to for my job, but this was so intuitive, and it's something that for years and years I wasn't able to do because I didn't have the time to actually color by hand. So just as far as production would go, that always got passed off to someone else to either color by hand, or illustrate digitally. And when I finally started working digitally, it was something I was able to pick up really easily and really quickly. So it's helped. It's just been a fun process for me, and I still feel like I'm learning every day. But I still keep rooted with my life drawing and my big pad of paper every week. But digital is, I'm almost doing, I'd say 90% of my work now is digital on Cintiq.
Thank you, that's really helpful.
Uh-huh. All right, so let's have another round of applause for Steve Thompson.
Thank you.